Lithium peroxide is a strong oxidizing agent with the formula Li2O2. It readily reacts with CO2 in the air, and for this reason, it's commonly used as an air purifier. Unlike other CO2 scrubbers, it has a very low molecular weight, which makes it particularly useful in spacecraft. On top of this, it also has the added benefit of releasing oxygen gas. To make the lithium peroxide, I use two main chemicals, 35% hydrogen peroxide and lithium hydroxide. The hydrogen peroxide was purchased from the store, and the lithium hydroxide was made in a previous video, starting from lithium metal. I honestly didn't really need to make it myself, and it can be pretty easily purchased from eBay. The procedure that I'm following for this preparation is from a patent, and I'll provide a link to it in the description. To start things off, I added 125 milliliters of 35% peroxide to a beaker. The next thing that we need to do is add about 50 grams of lithium hydroxide. I turn on my stir plate, and with vigorous stirring, we can start to add the lithium hydroxide. Immediately after adding it, it will start to react and produce lithium hydroperoxide. Things will slowly heat up as we continue to add the lithium hydroxide, and some of our hydrogen peroxide will start to break down. Hydrogen peroxide is quite sensitive, and it pretty easily breaks down into water and oxygen gas. So the bubbling that you see here is actually the release of oxygen gas, and the solution isn't boiling. The addition of the lithium hydroxide will heat things up, and we want to keep the temperature below something like 60 C. After adding a decent amount of lithium hydroxide, the stir bar started to have some troubles, so I had to dilute things with a little bit of distilled water. It took about 20 minutes, but we eventually add the last bit of lithium hydroxide. The reaction mixture was then covered with plastic wrap, and we let things stir for about 15 minutes. When I come back 15 minutes later, things have taken on a very slight yellow color. The beaker is then transferred to a hot plate, and we heat things up to about 100 C. The moment the temperature reaches 100 C, we take it off heat, and we pour it into a vacuum filter funnel. A vacuum is pulled to remove the liquid, and we should be left with our lithium hydroperoxide on the filter. On top of the hydroperoxide, we actually have a few chunks of lithium hydroxide that didn't react. So, using a scoopula, I quickly get rid of them. The hydroperoxide in the filter is then broken up using a glass stir rod. The next thing that we need to do is convert the hydroperoxide of lithium into the actual peroxide that we want. This conversion is carried out by heating the lithium hydroperoxide while under a vacuum. So what I'm doing here is transferring the hydroperoxide into a round bottom flask, and then I'm going to pull a vacuum and heat it up over an oil bath. This is our setup, where the flask is under vacuum, and we have an oil bath at around 120 C. The dehydration of the hydroperoxide to the peroxide is pretty uneventful, and visually not very much happens. I heated it under vacuum for about an hour, and when I was done, I was left with a nice dry powder. The lithium peroxide was then transferred directly from the flask to a storage container. The final yield was about 25 grams, which corresponds to a percent yield of about 52%. The patent that I was following advertised a yield of about 83%, so a yield of 52 is a little bit on the low side. Before proceeding on to doing any experiments, the first thing that I'm going to do is make sure that we actually have lithium peroxide. In order to do this, I'm going to carry out a very simple peroxide test. To carry out the test, we need to first prepare the test solution, which involves mixing about 1 gram of potassium iodide in about 10 milliliters of glacial acetic acid. I use a glass stir rod to mix things up, but most of the potassium iodide is going to remain undissolved. We're done making our test solution now, and all we need to do is add a little bit of our alleged lithium peroxide. When a small amount of the lithium peroxide is dumped in, you can see that immediately it starts to take on an orangey-yellow color. This color change occurs because the peroxide is a strong oxidizer, and it oxidizes the colorless I- ions to colored I2. With this positive result, we can move on and experiment a little with the lithium peroxide. The first thing that I wanted to do was to test out the CO2 scrubbing capabilities of the lithium peroxide. To carry out this simple test, I started by filling two test tubes with some CO2 gas. To the tube on the right, I then added probably way too much lithium peroxide. To test out the tube that contains only CO2, I light a match and put it inside. The match is extinguished almost immediately when it comes into contact with the CO2. Now when we try it with the tube that has the lithium peroxide, we can see that the match actually maintains a flame for quite a bit longer. In a CO2-only atmosphere like in the other tube, the match would have been extinguished almost immediately, so this is a good indication that oxygen is being produced. I went ahead and tried to reignite a burning stick, but there just wasn't enough oxygen to get a flame going again. If we look at the equation of the reaction between the lithium peroxide and CO2, we see that 2 moles of CO2 are used, and it produces 1 mole of oxygen. Gases at room temperature tend to occupy the same volume, and this means that if we're absorbing 2 moles of CO2 and only producing 1 mole of O2, we will at most be filling half of the tube with oxygen. Even if all of the CO2 were consumed, we'd get a maximum oxygen concentration of about 50%. Given that we have a maximum concentration of about 50%, it makes sense that we're not seeing the reactions we do when we have a tube filled with pure oxygen. Anyway, with that being said, I'm gonna move on and do some flame tests. For the flame test, I put a little bit of the lithium peroxide on the bottom of a pan, and then I shot it with a blowtorch. The important thing to notice here is the characteristic crimson-red color of lithium. I also tried to add a little bit of organic solvent to the peroxide and light it on fire. I tried it with a few different common solvents, and nothing really happened in each case. I didn't film it, but there were a few times where I got a pop, but that was probably the most that happened. I thought it was going to be much more reactive, and I was really surprised when I saw that not much happened. As a final experiment, I added a little bit of lithium peroxide to some hot water. When it's added to hot water, it very quickly reacts to form lithium hydroxide and oxygen gas. Anyway, that's it for now, and the next video that I'm going to be posting is on the reverse aldol of cinnamaldehyde to make benzaldehyde. As usual, I'd like to extend a big thanks to all of my supporters on Patreon, and especially those who donate $5 or more. Anyone who donates and supports me on Patreon gets to see my videos 24 hours before I release it to YouTube, and if you donate $5 or more, you get your name at the end of the video like you see here. In the next few months though, I want to work on my Patreon page a lot, and I want to get more rewards going and maybe even get some higher tier ones, and I want to also offer some Patreon exclusive content. Also, as usual, here's the videos that I've currently filmed and the ones I plan to work on. If you have any suggestions or ideas, please feel free to leave them in the comments. Wait.